Okay, next we have Peter from Hong Kong. He will talk about how to use Wordrator. This
session will be presented in English.
Okay, thank you everybody, and today I will present how to use the Wordrator. So, my name is Peter, and I'm from Hong Kong, and I'm a programmer, and focusing on system programming. So, today I want to show you what is Wordrator. Wordrator actually is a compiler to convert the very long language into C++. And it also gives you the runtime to execute the Wordrator. So before putting your Wordrator into a hardware, you can test it in your computer. So this is a very great tool for you to learn Wordrator programming. And it is also a very great tool for you to explore how to program the hardware. So that's why I want to introduce everyone how to use it in here. So have you heard about the Wordrator? So Wordrator is just like a very domain-specific programming language. And you know, if you write a program in any kind of language, the CPU will execute it. But the code you write in Wordrator, low CPU will execute it because the Wordrator is used to describe the hardware. For example, if you want to burn some logic gate into the hardware, you cannot use some generic programming language. You have to use some kind of VHD, we call it high-level discussion language. And Wordrator is one of them. So in the world, there are two famous HDL languages. The first one is Wordrator. The second one is VHDL. So what is the difference is the Wordrator is more industry-like. And VHDL is for education purpose. So many universities will use VHDL to do some exercise or lab, but for industry, almost 90% are using the Wordrator. So when you pick the language, you need to ask yourself, you want to do some project for university or industry. You want to do a project for industry. I think you should better pick Wordrator as the language. So you can see this graph is here is the Wordrator language. So if you cook the Wordrator language in here, it will turn into the hardware. So there are two kinds of hardware you can turn into. The first one is we call ASIC. So you burn the chip and then you use the Wordrator to describe how your chip running. So you burn the chip. The second one is called FPGA. So FPGA is a very special chip. You can program the gate inside to form a specific hardware function. So this is what Wordrator do. And Wordrator, if you look at Islam, half of the world is just Wordrator. So it is the compiler converting your code into the software and just run it. So you can say Wordrator is a compiler because it compiles the Wordrator into C++, and you can say it is a one-time. It also gives you the one-time to execute your code. So here I want to give you a real demo. So in my computer, I have installed WSL. So in here, you can see I got some code in here. So one of the code is the Wordrator. So in here, it's just an NGA. So I want to show you how the NGA works. So Let me open the Wordrator file. So this is the only Wordrator file. So if you have a look at the screen, the Wordrator is very simple. It got few pins in here. You can imagine your chips got five pins. We got three in pins, and one output pin, and one call pin. So we define what pin for. For example, this is the input pin, and this is the output pin. So for the output pin, you've got a very special keyword called register. So register is just a memory inside your chip to hold a value for a specific duration of time. So this is the register. So in here, it's very easy to understand. The output pin will be the input pin and each other. So this is a three pin and gate. So it's very easy, but what is this for? This is a very special Wordrator syntax. You cannot find it in other language because this is something we call sequential circuit. So for the sequential circuit, everything will not change until the clock changes, right? So this is mean when the clock rising up, so this is positive edge. So when the clock rises up from 0 to 1, this code will be executed.
So this cock will not always kill until the cock is rising. So this is what the warlock do. So we got the warlock files. The warlock file must be end with a .v, and we can try to compile it. So let's look at the make file. So the make file is very simple. So we call the warlock, and we pass some thread. The war thread is a warm warming. And we pass the trace trap. Because if we convert the Weblog into this bus, we want to check how everything changed during the time. So this is a trace and compile it to C++, this is the Weblog. And then you will convert the .v into the CPP. So very simple. So we got the CPP file in here, it's just a simulation file. So to make the Weblog work, we need to provide two files. The first one is the Weblog. The second one is the C++ file, which is the driver file we call to control how the Weblog change. So in here you can see the first line, we got the V and gate.h. So but we don't have it, right? The Weblog will generate the header file for you. So when you compile your Weblog, it converts to some header file. So this is one of the header file. And then we got the time. The time is for representing the time, and then we got a very special variable called VCD. Have you heard about the VCD? The VCD is not VUCD, it's a VCD format. So if you search VCD format in here, okay, I don't have internet. The VCD format is a dump file. So when you execute your weblog, it dump your pins into the VCD file. So later, you can use another tools, for example, the GDK way to view the VCD file. And then you can see how your chip is running. So this is the VCD. Okay, we got the main method, which is no different than traditional C++. And we create the gate. Okay, we create the instance of our weblog. So you can see we have a car called V and gate. The V and gate is generated by your and gate. So for the rest of the code, it's very easy. We just turn on the VCD. I want to dump the behavior into the VCD file called output of VCD. Later, I will show you how to view the VCD file. So in here, I just set the setting of each pin. For example, the call pin, the input pin, and etc. You can see this pin is actually the pin we define in the weblog file. So we define five pins in here, four of them are input, so we can set four pins in here. So we set all the four pins, and then we execute the UR means evaluation. Evaluation means capture the result. Capture the result to where is capture to the VCD file. And then we dump it to the VCD, and then we increase the time by one. So you can imagine there is a sequence of time, you increase it, the time keep rising, and then you keep changing the clock. So in here, I change the clock to one, and then I call evaluation again, and then I dump the pin to the VCD file. So I keep doing this. And because our weblog is a three pin and gate, so if all pins are one, and then the output will be one. And then the output will become one. So very simple. So and here I got the output file. So I just simply I clean it first. I clean it first. So the project will be very clean. I just got the output file in here. The weblog, the C++, and make fine. Then I type make. It will come out everything into the C++. So in here I got the output folder in here. So if you release the output folder, so I got the executable in here. So it is just the executable for your Linux. So I can just execute it. So I just type in this command. So I can execute the files. Okay. If I execute, it is very quick to finish because the C++ file is so simple. But here, you got the output file in here. You got the output file. So if you kept the output file, you can see what's going on inside the output file. So here. I try to explain what's VCD format to you.
So if I cut it, you can see the VCD file. It's just more like a JSON file, but it's very specific format. It got the time, it got the wire, because I got five pin here. And here is the symbol of the pin. So N is equal to com, sharp is equal to input 1, and so on. So you can see here, CO sharp mean set the pin to 0. Set the input pin here to 0, and then set the input pin to 0, for example. And then sharp 1 means I go to the next call. So sharp 0 and sharp 1 is the call. So the second clock, I set the pin, and then the third clock, I set the pin, etc. So the format actually is just human readable. So very easy for you to interrupt, but if you just read so many lines of the VCD, it is really nearly impossible to imagine how the pin is going. So we got the GDK wave in here, we just call type this GDK wave, and then I pass in the output VCD file. So when I pass enter, you can see I can use a VCD GDK wave to view the VCD, and then I just select all the pins, and then I insert in here. So it can display using a waveform. So you can see the clock is keep changing from 0 to 1 and from 1 to 0. And because our wave lock is setting to positive S, so all the pin will not set until it is just rising to the positive. So you can see if the pin 1 is 0, and then pin 2 is 0, pin 3 is 0, the output will be 0. The output will only to be 1. The output will be 1 only when all input pin are 1. So this is a very simple engage in here. But sometimes viewing the different pins, the value, using the GDK weight is also very hard. So my team has invented a little tool called a Quanta VCD component. So which is built by Java, which is we make it, and I show you how to. And then I just run the project. This is a very special program for you to view the VCD file. Okay, this is my program, and then I just opened it, and the program is totally open source, and you can grab it in GitLab. Okay, and then I just opened the output files. It should be in the desktop, and then I got the output files in here. So you can see I got all pins in here, and our software will display using one zero. So it will be easier for us to debug rather than using the GDK wave, because when you see it in the waveform, it's very hard to imagine what's going on. So instead of display it by waveform, we display it by number. And this program has a built-in formula, so you can just like the Excel, you type in some formula, it will cross-check the correlates for you. Because when you try to decode your chip, the chip may fail after millions of calls. You have to find out the error. If you will the waveform, it will be very hard. So this tool is totally open source. This tool can be found in our GitLab. So if you go to our GitLab, let me go for the intro first. Okay, if you go to our website, and we got many different open source projects, and I think almost projects are complete, so it is ready for use. And let me go for the website first. Okay, wait. I think the intro has some problem. I have joined my 5G. I tested today in another room, which is working.
Okay, thank you.
Maybe we wait a while. He is going to send me the intro.
My question is that your tool, you use the validator to generate the VCD,
yes.
And you pass the VCD to see that the data is match your input and output match your rules.
Yes,
right.
Correct.
But this seems a little odd to me because what I think is that when you write the code for validator, you can write those rules inside the simulation. So when the variator is when you drive the very log module with variator, you can check those rules at that time.
Yeah, you can do this also, but you will miss one problem. Yes. You are very sure what rules you are going to write. Then you can write in the web later. Yes, correct. But the rules writing in the web later will be purely C++. And our formula is more simpler. and we provide some regular expression matching, which is very hard to write in C++. So we still have an advantage. And because our tool is very good UI displaying in here, so you can keep adding the rule to see the result. So it will be much faster than just writing the rules in the regulator. So this is why we develop these tools. Yes, please.
Another question is that you use VCD because it's much simpler to pass.
Yes.
I think because in the other hand, is that VCD will be a much larger
when
you do a long simulation.
Yes, we are seeking a way to support another more compact format. Yes, you are correct, because VCD is a pen format. So it will be very, very big. But you know our computer is very powerful. So if the VCD is 10 GB, we still able to handle. So and Java nowadays is very fast. So to read a 10 GB file is just easy. So we put it aside, because our team is focusing on finish our WISC CPU in this year. So after we finish the CPU, we'll go back to enhanced tools, maybe support another more compact format.
Okay. Is there any other question you want to ask?
Okay. Thank you, everybody.
No, 谢谢大家。
Alright, thank you Peter for sharing about Shingle Lab. After today's launch, we will have the after section, which will be coming our next section. 分散式的一些应用之类的东西，对，就是分散式主板的东西，所以如果有兴趣的话，下午两点可以来这边，对，好，谢谢。